two good friends up on their 9th anniversary.
Amen.
And the mistress of someone is saying the word, the term, the number 9 does mean new birth. So we want to believe in God that God will be birthing some things here today.
Amen.
Someone said, thank you, Jesus. Let's acknowledge big God that praises, amen, for Randall Eugene. I'm going to do the same thing. Allison and Cynthia. Allison, come on, give God the praises for God. Oh, come on, you can do that. Let's give God the praises for him.
Hallelujah.
Aren't they beautiful and handsome, man? Come on, let's blow them a kiss. Amen. For wonderful, wonderful people they are. You can take your seats if you can, if you will. I want to acknowledge Woodline Deliverance Temple.
Amen.
Thank you for inviting us again. Amen. For this special occasion. Can you just give God the praises for all of you?
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
God bless you. Amen. My New Life family, I love and adore my New Life family. I'm telling you, they are the best church on this side of heaven. Come on, give God the praises for them. Amen. I love them. God bless them. Travel near and far. I want to acknowledge my son and daughter. They are pastors of Life Changing Christian Church.
Amen.
Center in Montevallo. Come on, give God the praises for Pastor and Maurice and Celestia Montevallo. Young lady, amen. God bless you. And that lovely lady that you see up here introducing my old name, amen. She is my bride, my wife, my girlfriend, my cruise partner.
Yes.
We go on a cruise next weekend, amen. Yes. Come and give God a praise for Lady Cynthia. Not to be remiss, the Bible says, always give honor to your father and mother. My
amen.
Mother is in the house. I want to acknowledge her. Come on.
Amen.
God bless you, amen. Let's acknowledge. If it wouldn't be for her, it wouldn't be for me. Amen. More than one way. I just really thank God for an opportunity to be here on this special occasion. They have really grown upon my heart. Much respect and honor. The only thing that's really left for us to do to continue in this kind of fellowship relationship with this break bread together, just sit down and just break bread and talk about the goodness of the Lord and everything else. And I look forward for the day. Not too much bread, though. I'm trying to maintain that. But I look forward for the day for us just to get together outside of the services. I think true fellowship is not just what you do behind the pulpit. It's what you do after the service. I don't have a witness in the house.
Amen.
Let's get into this word, amen, that the Lord has for us. If you don't mind, and I give honor to the theme that you have given, turn your scriptures, if you will, and once you have found it, take liberty to stand. I think we're standing for so much today. Some things, not even the word of God, we're just still standing. But all those different things is not going to last. It's so the one thing I found consistent that always stand with you. And that's the word of the Lord.
Amen.
Come with me, if you will, to, let's start off in 2 Kings. Let's start there first. 2 Kings, the second chapter. 2 Kings, the second chapter. I believe the Lord is getting ready to take us somewhere. I don't ever believe when the Lord is ministering to us, we are where we are. But we are sitting in heavenly places. Someone said, thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Physically, we may be here, but spiritually, we really not here. We are in the midst of a cloud of witnesses, of a heavenly host. The Bible says in Peter that even the angels are curious about the gospel that we preach. They gather around us because they are stirred to know the revelation that the Holy Spirit has given unto us. tap your neighbors on the shoulder and say, my brother, my sister.
My sister.
We are in the midst.
We are in the midst.
Of the holy presence of God.
Of the holy presence of God. Amen.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Well, I feel the anointing on this already.
Thank you.
Capture us, God. Arrest us.
Yes, Lord.
Take us into captivity. Do what you will with us.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Come with me to the 9th verse of the 2nd chapter of 2 Kings. If you're going to read it as such. And as they were crossing, Elijah said to Elisha, ask for something, and I will do it for you before I am taken away from you. And Elijah said, let a double portion of your spirit or anointing be upon me. Somebody said, I want a double. He said, you have asked for a difficult thing, an awful hard thing. But if you see me, someone said, you got to see him. When I am taken from you, it will happen to you. If not, it will not. And they continue walking and talking. A chariot of fire and a horses of fire separated the two of them. Elijah went up. Someone say he went up.
He went up.
By a whirlwind into heaven. Elijah was watching and crying, my father, the chariot of Israel and his horses. And he did not see him again. So I'm trying to say he did not see him no more. Then he grabbed his own clothes and tore them in two pieces. He picked up, someone said, up again, up. The robe of, or the mantle of Elijah that fell on him. Then he returned and stood on the bank of the Jordan. And he took the robe or the mantle of Elijah that fell from him and struck the water. And said, where's the Lord God of Elijah? Where he had struck the water. It parted from one side to the other, and Elijah crossed over. Now turn with me to 1 Timothy real quickly as we will take our seats shortly afterwards. 1 Timothy, the 5th chapter and the 17th verse. Said, let the elders who rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially those who labor. Y'all better hear this. In the word and doctrine. For the scripture says,
yes,
you shall not muzzle the ox that treads out the grain,
yes,
and the laborer is worthy of his reward.
Yes.
Take your seats if you will. I'm going to minister before you. And every now and then you may see me just dip back like this because I'm getting around the flowers so I can see over there too. I believe the Lord want to do something very specific here this afternoon. I believe the Lord want to take us to higher dimensions and greater dimensions. So I want to be able to title this, if you don't mind, just so you can have something to put on your notes as a heading. New Kingdom Dimensions. New Kingdom Dimensions. And the double that released, the double. Look at your neighbor and tell you, as a neighbor.
Neighbor.
I want to release the double.
I want to release the double.
In my life.
In my life.
Now some of you really didn't get that, but let me quantify those that's in this house real quickly. If you have experienced any kind of shame, The Bible says in Isaiah 60 that I will give you double for your shame. Now, maybe that don't qualify everyone, but I'm going to find two people in this house who have been through any kind of shame all in right. your life.
Yeah.
Tell you this, your neighbor.
Neighbor.
I know he's talking to me.
I know he's talking
to me.
Yes,
because
yes.
every now and then, see, it don't have to be something that you done wrong. Amen. Because the Bible didn't say amen for you to be ashamed. That's when you had done something wrong. But shame is when, amen, you may be doing something right and the enemy want to come and try to trip you up or cause you to stumble in a public manner. You didn't do anything wrong. Matter of fact, you're doing things just right. You're doing things that God expects for you to do. And the enemy want to expose you as though you are a wrongdoer. And he try to bring shame upon you. But I want to go ahead and give you some good news. Amen. For those who experience any kind of shame or persecution or any type of gossip or any type of put down or mockery, I want to let you know that God is getting ready to introduce you unto your double here this afternoon. Look at somebody, give them a high five and tell them, I'm about to get my double.
I'm about to get my double.
Now, let me help y'all even more so. See, there are lands that are available. I was in the Navy and I traveled to different land masses. I went to South America and I went to all of the Virgin Islands and the Caribbean Islands and so forth. I went overseas to Europe and some other islands overseas, and I realized there are different lands. Even Africa, I traveled there. There are different lands. Amen. But there is one land that the Bible described in the same book of the prophet Isaiah that we need to visit. It's not Africa, it's not Europe, it's not China, it's not Japan, it's not Cuba or South America. I wouldn't mind Hawaii, but it's not Hawaii either. The Bible said that I will bring you into the land of double.
All right.
There's actually a land that exists for you to live in, that you can live in double for the rest of your life. Oh, help me God. I'll tell you this, neighbor, I don't know where you're going, but I'm going to the land of double.
Going to the land of double.
But it's a way that you release the double in your life, and you just can't get it just because, amen, that you want it. It's a certain way that you release the double. Let me start off from here, because see, we need to understand what's being released in the earth, because how you get the double is through honor, and I'm gonna teach the answer for you, but you receive the double through honor.
Wow.
And see, what the church have not demonstrated and represent this key of the kingdom of receiving the double by giving honor to those who are over us. And unfortunately, the world have looked at the church. And the church the world have imitated the actions of the church. You don't believe it? Let's look back over the years. Because when we begin to allow the enemy to expose our leaders and mock them in public, that's not the way of God. The Bible even tells us in Corinthians that if we got an issue in a church, don't take it to ABC, don't take it to NBC, don't take it to Fox News, don't take it to the Common Courthouse. The Bible says if you got an issue, then take it to the church. As a matter of fact, Paul said it like this in the epistles. He said, if there's an issue, a legal matter between you and somebody else, don't even take it to the courts of this world. Don't you know you're going to be judges over the angels? He said, handle the matter inside of the house. Or take this, a neighbor. There's some things you don't need to do in front of the world. When I was younger, my sisters and I, you know how family can be every now and then, and my sisters and I, we would get into it and arguing, and we was outside, and And so we just move on in the projects. And you know how we can be, you know, moving up the project. And we just got into a real nice neighborhood. And my sister and we was outside acting foolish. And listen, you know, we had people that would just gather around, just started looking at us while we were going back and forth arguing. And my mom just stood at the door. Amen. She looked out the door and began to look at us and said, "What y'all doing?" And she called us unto her. She said, "You may not realize what you're doing, but you are making a spectacle of the family by acting a fool in front of everybody. Because they're just looking at you, they're staring at you." He said, "Don't you realize you may have some argument, you may have a disagreement, but do it inside of the house. Don't do it outside, because they may not understand the family dynamics of what's going on." And so when we allow, amen, the exposure of leaders, when they fall in different places, we allow that to be, amen, publicly exposed. They allow the world to see how we handle things and handle people in the house. And then so you know that people in the world begin to do the same thing.
Yeah.
Because you must understand that we are called the salt of the earth. And the meat must taste like the salt. The salt does not taste like the meat. The salt is what flavors the meat. So since we are the salt of the earth, then we do not taste like the world. The world tastes like us. So there are times when the world look at us and they imitate us in how and what we do. So I begin to look at what's going on. And years ago, some of you may not remember this, but I remember when President Obama, amen, would stand up in the middle of a congressional speech, and this someone would stand up and call him on his name. Disrespect.
Yeah.
Sometimes when you acknowledge that he's the president, call him Obama.
Yeah.
Come on, somebody.
Yeah.
And then you begin to see this disrespect and dishonor among leaders of high offices. Do I have a witness somewhere? You begin to see that. You begin to witness that. And then you begin to trickle on down from the highest office, amen, to the schools and the police officer and teacher until it got down into the homes and the fathers and the mothers begin to be dishonored as well.
Yeah.
Because it didn't start at the White House. It started in God's house first. Oh, come on, somebody. And so then you begin to realize that, wait a minute, we are setting a pattern here.
Wow.
And so I begin to realize that the church is the one who provides the example, provide the way. And so when we begin to do what is right, all of a sudden reverence is placed in the world. That the world began to imitate the church. Do I have a witness in here? And so let's go a little bit further, if you will, because this is what 2 Thessalonians, the second chapter, say. It said that there will come a time where signs and wonders will be given from the enemy. And he will give a lying wonder, a lying sign. Amen. So much so that God will even cause a strong delusion that even the church will believe.
Wow.
Are y'all gonna hear that? So what do you mean, man of God? In other words, he said this is an antichrist spirit. Can you just hang with me for a little while? This antichrist spirit will send a strong delusion to the church, will even believe it themselves.
Wow.
So what's going on? In other words, we will begin to see and begin to perceive that it's okay to dishonor men and women of God. And we will pick up this spirit that is an antichrist spirit. Tell your neighbor, not me.
Not me.
Tell your other neighbor, not me. Because see, we have to learn how to honor men and women of God. Not just those who are over us, but every person that beside us, behind us, in front of us, we have to learn how to honor.
Wow.
This is what the Bible says, amen, Psalms 82, amen, that the world is off its foundation because of the judgment that we refuse to render.
Right.
So in other words, it's on our responsibility. So tell your neighbor real quick, neighbor, I want to learn how to honor.
Right.
So I can release the double.
Double.
Okay.
Amen. Well.
Well, let's talk about this for a few moments here. Wow. One of the laws that, in order to release the double, is the law of reciprocation. In other words, you're going to get, amen, what you give.
Wow. Amen.
You're going to reap what you sow.
Amen.
And we just say it like this. What goes around comes around.
Well.
Do I have a witness? Matter of fact, this is what the apostle said. He said, be not deceived. For God is not mocked. Come on, somebody. If you sow in flesh, you're going to reap corruption. But you sow for the spirit, you're going to reap it. I wish I had me a witness. You must understand, whatever you sow on the ground is what you're going to get back.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, look at today. Say, neighbor, I think I want a harvest.
But
depending on what kind of seed you sow will determine the type of harvest you're going to receive. See, everyone is a counter to receive a harvest. But it's going to be based on your seed, that kind of harvest you're going to have. It's called the law of reciprocation. It's called equality. Whatever you sow, amen, you shall reap. If you sow sparingly, you're going to reap sparingly. If you sow much, you're going to what? Reap.
Yeah. Much.
So watch it. We're going to go a little bit further. The second is the law of honor. And the law of honor is this right here. The Bible says, if you can give and honor a disciple, then you shall receive a disciple reward. If you honor a prophet, then you will receive a prophet's reward. Come on, somebody. If you honor a righteous man, then you will receive a righteous man a reward. So your reward is based on who you honor. Based on your reception and your giving of honor, if you want to get something back greater than what you sold, let me help you out. By you being here today, so I'm here to honor the man and woman of God. And by you honoring them, you put something in the crowd. You're not going to leave out empty. I believe I got some folks out here that realize I didn't come in vain, baby. I came to receive what the Lord has for me. And I came here to honor the man and woman of God. But let me go just a little bit deeper than that, because really the double is a smaller portion. What street is this? This is 221 62nd Street South, right? So we are on 221 62nd Street South, and we are in Birmingham. Do I have a witness? And we are in Alabama. Do I have a witness? And we are in the United States of America. Do I have another witness? Part of North America. Are y'all still with me? And North America is on the earth. Do I have a witness? And the earth is in the universe. Do I have the Milky Way, the galaxy? And the Milky Way is in the universe. Let me go a little bit further. And the universe is in God. Now wait just a minute. Let me help you. Because so you need to know what's on the inside of you. So let me start back over. You are now at 221 62nd Street South. And that's in Birmingham. And Birmingham is in Alabama. And Alabama is in the United States of America. And the United States of America is in North America. North America is in the earth. And the earth is in the galaxy. And the galaxy is in the universe. And the universe is in God. Now wait just a minute. God is not in the universe.
Oh,
but the universe is in God. Let me help you out real quick. Because you need to understand. So, Father, I thought you said that the double, it was a small portion. This, it is a small portion. Let me describe how small it is. Because in all of that, amen, God lives on the inside of you. Let me help you out. No matter how big the universe is, God is bigger. But no matter how big God is, he lives on the inside of you. Let me help you. He's bigger than your double. He's bigger than Birmingham. He's bigger than Alabama. He's bigger than the United States. He's bigger than the earth. He's bigger than the galaxy. He's bigger than the universe. You serve a mighty God. You serve an awesome God. He's unlimited. He has no boundaries.
Hallelujah.
You got to go beyond the double. You got the fullness.
on
the Godhead, dwelling on the inside of you.
Glory be to God.
But I learned, Pastor, before we can want a seven-tier cake, we got to first believe God for a two-layer cake. Come on, somebody. I feel like preaching. Because I'm preaching better than you praising God. So. Let me say that again. Before you believe God, amen, for a seven-tier. Identify here this afternoon. I'm going to pack my bag and go home and get ready for my cruise next week. So the first problem is right here, that there's a strong delusion that the enemy had released in the house of not honoring the men and the women of God to the temperature, to the standard that God desires. And let me help you a little bit further. In other words, amen, the Antichrist spirit is released in two different types of animals. And you can find it in the history part of the Bible. Number one, with David. David said that he was over his sheep, his father's sheep. And he had to defend the sheep, amen, from a lion and a bear. Well, where did that come from? The Bible says that the enemy go to and fro roaring like a lion. And so David said that I found a sheep that belonged to my father's fold in the mouth of a lion. The Antichrist spirit wanted to get in the house and take the sheep out of the fold. And David said, I went to the lion and took the sheep out of the lion's mouth. The second one, amen, is the bear. How many of y'all remember the story? He said he went to the bear, and the bear is a form of an Antichrist spirit that went into the fold and take one of the sheep out of the fold. David said, I grabbed the beard of that bear so I can take the sheep out of this mouth. So let me go a little bit further into this. When you read out of 2 Kings, the second chapter, amen, when Elijah came out, amen, of the Jordan River, he was getting ready to go to Bethel, the house of God, the city. And all of a sudden, there were some people that came out of the woods, the Bible said, and they began to mock him. Y'all quiet.
I remember.
They began to mock him and say, yeah. Why don't you go up, Eliza? Why don't you go up? And they told him, you bald head man. They made fun of him. They dishonored him. They disrespected him. He was the prophet of God, and they didn't know how to honor him. And the Bible said that Elijah turned around and cursed them. And watch this. And what came out of the woods? The Bible said it was two female bears that came out of the woods and ate 42. Number 42 represent the spirit of the Antichrist.
Wow.
Because when the Antichrist comes, he will be on the earth for 42 months.
Wow.
Tell you this, a neighbor. We bind any spirit.
He bind any spirit.
They come in our house.
They come in our house.
They try to bring dishonor of any kind.
Try to bring dishonor of any kind. Amen. My God.
Are y'all hearing this?
Yes.
I honor my man and woman of God.
Yes.
I honor my parents.
Yes.
I honor my wife. I honor my, let me find somebody to pray. I honor my family. Come on, somebody. I honor my spiritual parents. I honor my God. I honor, amen, who he is over my life. You're not going to stop me from praising God. You can sit down like you don't want to praise God, but I'm going to honor God. The Bible says, from the rising of the sun to the going down of the sun, I will bless the name of the Lord.
Yes, yes.
It's a spirit of honor. Some say it's a spirit of honor. It's a spirit
of honor.
So there's a strong delusion that have crept into the church, amen, and trying to allow us not to honor people. Because when we don't honor, it's hard for us to receive the double that God wants us to
have.
And that's why the church struggles. Let me go to number two. Number two. The second problem is, Pastor Allison, is that we, the body, is stuck in one dimension. Let me talk about it. The dimension that we are stuck in, because you must understand, the body of Christ, the church, is called many different things in the Bible. Can I talk about it? It's called many different things. It's called ecclesia, which is the called out ones. Yeah. It is called the one new man. It is also called the bride of Christ. It's also called a holy nation. It is also called the chosen generation. It's also called the peculiar people. It's also called the royal priesthood. As a matter of fact, the Bible also said he called us the rose of Sharon. Because the bridegroom was talking to the bride and called us the rose of Sharon. I wish I had me a winner. You must understand, you are called many things in different dimensions. And what you behold is what you become. Once you get a revelation that you are king, you begin to walk like a king. Once you get a revelation you are a priest, you walk like a priest. Once you get a revelation you are a peculiar people, you walk like a peculiar person. Once you get a revelation you are chosen, you walk like you chosen. You talk like you chosen. You praise God like you are chosen of God. What you behold. When you behold that revelation in that dimension, you become in that way. Just because you read it does not mean that you are.
My God. Say that again.
Well, man of God, you said that we were stuck in one dimension. Yes, we are. We are stuck in a dimension called sheep.
Sheep. Wow.
Can I talk about it?
Mm-hmm.
We're stuck in a dimension because the Bible called the church the sheep of God as well.
Yeah.
And we are stuck in a dimension called sheep. He said, what's wrong with sheep? There's nothing wrong with sheep. Because the Bible say, amen, that when you're a sheep, you his sheep, you know his voice. But what's wrong with a sheep is